What's up, guys? We're the Fighting Messiah. So today's video, we got something very, very different. Okay. So basically, about a week ago, one of the lecturers at my uni emailed me. Really nice guy by the name of Dr. Saul Albert, and he's a media and communications lecturer. And he basically asked me to come and speak to his class. So what we're doing today is we're going to be doing a Q&A session for the media and communications class. So I'm basically doing a lecture as a first year student, which is ridiculous. We're doing media and communications because this whole social media influencer type thing is such a new market and such a fast growing thing. They want to talk to someone that does it, so he thought of me. So yeah, that's crazy that we're about to do this actually. So he sent me the questions already. I looked over some of them, kind of thought about some of the answers I'm going to give. I'm going to go there. He's limited the numbers to only 10 students actually, so that people can actually have a chance to like have a more open dialogue. But yeah, it's still crazy, man. It's actually crazy. But you know what, we need to get there. I'm not running late, which I usually am, but because we can't run late for something like this, but I need to get there now. So I'm gonna see you guys in a bit. Quickie though, guys, before we get into the video, I've got a huge announcement to make, and that's that Gymshark's Black Friday sale is going live on Thursday, the 18th of November, where you can get up to 70% off your favorite items from selected lines on the Gymshark website. So on the 18th of December at 7 p.m, the sale is going to be live. And if you want to support me, make sure you use my Gymshark link. The link is in my Instagram bio, it's in my YouTube description. So when the sale goes live, make sure you shop, make sure you're there ready, because stuff is going to fly off the shelves. But anyways, let's get back to the video.
Thank you. Sorry,
you go. Okay, so my name is Nathaniel. I'm from South London. My main interest was in like bodybuilding, fitness, and things like that. But I was also really into YouTube and like posting, making videos. So I tried to kind of combine that, and it kind of came into what my channel is now, which is mostly to do with, you know, fitness. But I'm also trying to transition it to be slightly more general, so it has slightly more like mainstream appeal. So if you don't go to the gym, you can still watch my videos and enjoy it, or there's some content that still relates to you in some way. So that's why recently I've been doing a lot more vlogging and things like that. And yeah.
I wonder if you could just tell us a little bit about how you set up your channel, how you first got into it. What was your kind of pathway into this culture?
Yeah. So my channel actually started on hair videos, which is so unrelated and random to what I do now. But that was actually going decently well. But the thing is, so that was in April 2017, but then September 2017 is when I really started to get into the gym. And then I made one gym video, and then February of the next year I cut off my hair, and then that was it with my hair channel pretty much. Had a short lifespan, but yeah, so that was actually going quite well. And what that actually meant like, was I built up a decent amount of subscribers at that point. But then when I transitioned my channel, all the previous subscribers were there for like hair videos. So now when I'm doing fitness videos, my engagement is now dropping a lot lower than it was before, so I was kind of wondering what was going on. And that remained at that point for maybe like a year and a half. So from that point, like February 2018 until maybe September 2019, I'd say my channel was pretty much completely stagnant. But then, yeah, it was weird, because again, with the start of my channel and what kind of got my channel to the point it is now, it's so unrelated to what I do. But 2019, obviously with GCSE results, I'm actually really well on my GCSE, so I made a video on how I got all nines, and that one literally just went like viral basically, and then that exposed people to my fitness content, and then that's where my fitness content just started going up, and started getting a lot more views, a lot more exposure, and then yeah, that's pretty much, it's pretty much been riding off that wave since then. So both the start of my channel and kind of the growth of my channel both happened in things which are completely unrelated and almost random, but that's kind of how I got to the point now.
Actually, this is a business, right? Nathaniel's running a very successful business while at university, which is quite an achievement, and I think it's also an opportunity to learn a lot. So it's a wonderful opportunity to see how this industry works, to learn about all of its different kind of dynamics and what it is that it means that your university videos are growing in the way that they are and are getting so much attention.
How did you get into Gymshark? Like, how did that whole process start with them?
Yeah, so I'd been a fan of Gymshark, like the one I was a big fan of was David Lay. He was like a young guy, did fitness and stuff like that, and he was one of the youngest people sponsored by Gymshark, and I really loved his videos and everything like that. And because of him, like I remember 2019, I think is when I bought my first Gymshark stuff, and it was these stringers. And then my videos from that point on, like I always wore these stringers. So I think in about December, I got an Instagram DM from the main Gymshark Instagram account. And it was in school, and I literally lost my composure completely. My phone got taken away at school because of it, but I didn't care because I got that message. And then they sent me a package of clothes, and I did like a little like review, whatever, like unboxing, whatever, on YouTube. Then they got me up to their lifting club, because they have they're based in Solihull, so they've got a HQ and they've got a lifting club. Lifting club is like this like state of the art gym. So I went up there, talked to the management guys, and I think I made a decently good impression. And then they invited me to, they had an opening party for a store in London. This is in February, and they invited me to that. At this point, I'm not a Gymshark athlete yet. And then at the opening party, I saw Ben Francis, the owner. And the type of person that I am, like, I'll literally go up and speak to anyone. So I literally saw him, I just went up and spoke to him, and like, we had a good conversation. And then after the fact, like, after the response, they told me that he said he really liked me, and I made a really good impression on the fact I just went up and spoke to him and things like that. So I think at that point, I think I was already going to get sponsored. I don't know if it was like set in stone. And then in March, they called me up to go to the lifting club again. But then literally the date I was meant to go was when lockdown started. So it was postponed until like May, and then it was an online one. And they asked me to be a Gymshark athlete. And yeah, so that was then. And that's probably one of the things that I'm probably most proud about, because even like still now I'm the youngest person on Gymshark, which is crazy. Recently I've done a lot more things with them, then Black Friday stuff is coming out and I'm gonna be in that stuff, and I'm really looking forward to it. So yeah, that's gonna be this month, so yeah, I'm looking forward to that. But yeah.
It's a bit personal. I just wonder what your family says about when you started to become like really, hitting numbers and gaining, followers. So how did your family react?
My dad was like over the moon. He's still like always watching my, like, as much as I'm like focused on like the numbers and stuff, but like he's literally the same way. He'll be looking at my videos like, these ones did well at this period, you were doing well in this button. So he's always kind of watching and stuff. So he was like really happy it was going well, because my parents had seen how long I was doing YouTube for. I'd been doing it for like over 2 years and putting in loads of effort, and this is like still when I'm young, like 15, 16, putting loads of effort, and it wasn't going as well at that point. So when it finally did start to go up, it was quite surreal, and I feel like it clicked with them more. Like, say we'll go out and then someone will stop me and say they watch my YouTube videos, because like they just like, I don't know, I feel like it's different when you just see numbers on the screen compared to like actual real world like impact, like people actually coming up to you. So I feel like they probably started to like get a better understanding when that stuff started to happen. But my parents were always supportive, and that's one thing that I really liked about my parents, is that any like endeavor that I took, they were always really supportive of it. And because YouTube is so new, and obviously it's hard to like I don't know, a lot of, I feel like some parents would be quite traditional in the sense of they just want to go to university and do etc. And obviously I still did those things, but I feel like with YouTube and in general, my parents gave me like just the go ahead to go for anything that I wanted to go for. And especially with YouTube, it became a lot, I think, a lot easier to understand when the ad revenue and stuff start coming in, like, okay, this is actually a viable way of making money and things like that. So yeah, my parents were always really supportive.
Do you consider not going to uni to put more effort into your life?
100%, 100%. I told my parents, yeah, I was always gonna go uni, but in my own head, I was like, bro, I don't know if this is for me. But I think the main thing is that since coming to uni, all my social media like platforms have gone up, and I think that you can, a lot of things in life have to do with the way that you see them. You can see uni as, oh, I'm going to have to balance YouTube with it. Or you can see it as, this is now giving me an opportunity to make content that I wouldn't otherwise be able to make. So for example, I posted a day in the life, maybe a month and a half ago. It was just a general day in the life, and that got maybe like 30,000 views. And then I posted a day in the life literally 3 days ago, and then she just titled a day in the life for a Loughborough University student. Obviously, if I didn't go to Loughborough, I couldn't make that video. And that one did way better. I think that's like 70,000 views in like 3 days. So like, that's just, you can see it, a lot of things in the life just, again, depend on the way that you look at it. And so me looking at university in the way of, okay, this is going to be your opportunity to make more content, I think if you go into that mindset of then, I'm not going to be able to do certain things because of it, I think it's beneficial. Also, one thing with my channel is that I think people like the relatable aspect. With a lot of fitness influencers, obviously the life that they live is very not realistic, in the sense that they can literally just go to the gym, take pictures, post them, and make loads of money. So me actually just going, still going, like when I was doing it, still going to sixth form, still doing it, now going to university is a lot more relatable for people, because people that are into the gym that do go to university can't just, you know, sit around all day and then go to the gym and chill. They're going to have to find ways to balance it and things like that. So I think me being able to do that has made it a lot more relatable for other people and probably actually helped me. Because there's a bunch of influencers out there who just, you know, have a really nice physique and take really nice pictures and stuff like that. But I think maybe what's helped me is the fact that obviously I try that stuff as well, but I try to always make it like relatable for people, and I think that's what people appreciate about my channel. And yeah,
like representation has become something I think people are a lot more conscious of, because what people are exposed to makes a like a big impact on the things that they strive for. So if you don't see yourself necessarily like represented in a certain like career or something like that, you're less likely to strive for it. But yeah, I think with me, I think going to university would like made more sense, because if my thing, the whole thing before was also like balancing YouTube and stuff with school and the gym, like going to university is just a continuation of that. And I think people did, a lot of people appreciate the fact that maybe I didn't need to go to university, but I still went anyway. So I think some people like saw that and like kind of maybe looked at me in a different way, because people have this kind of maybe idea about like fitness influencers, maybe that some of them are maybe not the most intelligent, they're just like, just, you know, just they just go to the gym and just lift weights, like isn't anything like that. So I think it's also like a shows people a different side to it. Like you can still do that stuff and still, you know, be academic and yeah, maybe provide a side to it that people haven't seen as much before. So yeah, I think that might be another reason why some of the university videos are doing better, because in the sense that I'm doing it in terms of like with the bodybuilding aspect of it and the fitness aspect of it, I don't think that's maybe something that people have done before, like including all of those. So maybe that's another reason why. But yeah, I think I don't know. I'll say to myself though, it's actually quite hard to do it right now. Like balancing everything right now is hard, and obviously first year is the easiest it's ever gonna be. So I'm kind of thinking like, how am I gonna do this second or third year? But we'll cross that bridge when we get there. And yeah. So
I think this way you can inspire people better as well.
Think with social media, it's hard, but it's also not. And like I explained in a way, it's hard in the process of building it up. But when you've actually built it up, it's actually not that hard to maintain. So you actually have a lot of free time, a lot of hours. So in the summer, even though I was making videos and stuff like that, there were times I was actually like, relatively bored, because you have a lot of free time. So I feel like it's probably best for my time to go to university. And it's like, because a lot of my friends that do it, like they have to, I think, like constantly travel and stuff like that just to feel like they're doing something, because realistically, like a lot of them, all they have to do is post a couple of pictures a month, and that's their obligation for their brands and their sponsorships and things like that. So I feel like within that time, it probably makes more sense for me to go to university. And even me going, I'll finish when I'm 21, and I'm still really young at that point, so they still have my whole life ahead of me. So yeah. So there's been times when people come up to me and showed them like a before and after picture of them and said like you're the reason I got into the gym. And obviously when people show you that and they're like, well, you can physically see they're so happy about their progress. It's like, it's really, it touched you a lot. And then there's other times of someone has come to me in the gym and said like, I'm an international student and I watch your videos to help with my English and things like that. And it's like, I don't know, things like that, I feel like they make a lot more of a difference, because as I said, with social media, it just, when you're actually in it, it's all just like numbers on the screen. And sometimes you can kind of not see the actual personal aspect to it because you can't physically see the people, but it's when you actually see people in real life and they tell you like how, like, you know, since I've gone to university, I'll see people that say like, you're the reason why I started the gym and things like that, and they're like obviously a lot happy with, you know, the way they feel and the way they look and things like that. It's quite like inspiring for me as well to keep going, because that's the impact that it's having on people. So yeah, I've had quite a few times with that, and yeah, it makes you want to keep going. It gives you hope that like what you're doing is actually like meaningful, and it's not just, because obviously I'm quite focused also on the business aspect to it, but I feel that stuff kind of has even a bigger impact than maybe just like making money and things like that, because you're actually helping people. So yeah.
Well, I've got one more question, if that's all right. Or maybe two. One is, I'll start with the business question, because I'm really interested in the division of your business between sponsorships from Gymshark or from MyProtein or from the other sponsors you have, and the revenue from ads on YouTube and other platforms, and whether there's, how do the sponsorships work? Is it just like randomly people email you? So I wonder if you could say something about that, because it's not something that I think is widely known. I don't know.
Okay, so my three primary income streams is my sponsorship contract, then the revenue I make from YouTube directly, so that'd be the AdSense, and then it will be my own personal online training plans. And so with the sponsorships, the way that it works, so oftentimes the way that they'll introduce themselves to you will either be via email or via the actual Instagram account from that company, and then you'll have some dialogue with them. You'll discuss your terms. Obviously, I don't have a manager. I do most of the things myself. Obviously, I'll ask my parents and like if they think certain things are a good idea. But for me, the way that most of my contracts work is that it will be a specified amount of posts per month, and then oftentimes your YouTube videos that you need to make, and then there's also specific times through the year when you do certain things. So Black Friday's coming up now, Gymshark, I have to post certain things at certain times because of Black Friday, because that's really a time where like there's a lot of push, they want to push things a lot. Yeah, those are the main things. Then obviously with those, you're on a salary, and then you also get commission, and there's usually a different commission for new customers and existing customers. So it might be like 15% commission for a new customer and 10% commission for an existing customer, something like that. And obviously the longer that you're with a company and the bigger your social media platform is, often the more that they'll give you as a salary. So obviously it's come to a point now, I've been with most of my companies for either a year or coming up to like 2 years now. So my protein contract literally just renewed 29th of October on my birthday, because I couldn't get signed until I was 18. So my contract all starts every year on my birthday basically. So I'm on a new contract with them now. So that's like, you know, like a big thing. It's obviously the salary and stuff goes up, and it's good. So with also with the YouTube, that's that basically you get money from advertisements, basically ads shown in your videos. And so obviously the more views you get, the more ad revenue you get. And this varies based on the industry, and also varies based on the time of year, and can also vary based on like what video you post. So I do a video, I don't know, recently like a lot of the vlogs and stuff like that, the CPM on those seems to be a lot higher than maybe some of the fitness videos. And CPM also usually comes down to how easy it is to advertise off of that video. So some of the industries with the highest CPMs are like makeup and finance and things like that.
Yo, so what are you doing, James?
We're benching, we're doing pause bench for the powerlifting program.
This guy's always skating away from pause bench, yeah, man.
I don't like it.
Bro, well, we have to do it. You've got to do it. But yeah, we're going to train. I just went and got some food. I went to James just to get some free, because I didn't have any free.
We went to get his camera.
I left my camera in Edward Herbert Golden. I don't know how. It's literally sitting exactly where I left it. God was on my side today.
For
so
an yeah. hour.
Literally an hour it was there. Deadest YouTuber ever. But anyway, we're going to get a workout in. Enjoy the video.